Hello everyone, welcome to another video. So, if you haven't been watching my channel all week and been living under a rock, literally, you would have already known that I've been going at it head-to-head with a Australian news outlet called Channel 7. They put a hit piece out on veganism, a really disgraceful 100% bias hit piece. Upon investigation, because it was so suspicious, we found out that the chairman of Channel 7 is actually a billionaire beef tycoon. Surprise, surprise, I know. They gave me a master interview, and because I'm a little bit suspicious of these media places, I actually recorded the master interview. Now, it's an audio recording. This wasn't a private conversation. If you want to say I'm releasing private conversations, it wasn't. There were six other people in the room, literally. I was a little bit suspicious that my cameraman wasn't allowed in the room, so we couldn't film, you know, the whole interview and then release it later. This is the first interview that I've done that I'm not allowed to actually film as well. The full scope of this interview is here. It's the whole interview. So you can see exactly what they omitted, what they left out, the health, you know, my health arguments, you know, the full scope of what I said. You can see exactly how they edit these pieces and what they put in. So I'm sure old Denham, the old bloke that interviewed me, won't mind, because this was a completely public conversation with six other people. This was completely recorded. Channel 7 just choose to release what they want. I'm releasing the full interview here, and you guys can watch it through and get a proper idea of how they edit these pieces together, what they use, what they don't, and just in the interest of full transparency, which I don't think Denham would have said anything that he wouldn't have said publicly anyway. I was doing most of the talking, and yeah, here it is. Watch it through. It's quite interesting. Tell us what you think in the comments section, and I hope you all enjoy the full interview that Channel 7 Sunday Night gave me. Here it is.
Why London as your current place?
The UK is becoming one of the vegan capitals of the world now. The movement is growing rapidly over here. There's a lot of activism over here. There's more vegan options here because there are more vegans here, basically. And I felt that this was the perfect place for the message to spread really fast, because there's 66 million people here on a small island. In Australia, there's like 20 million people spread out on the second biggest continent on Earth. So for me, we could travel city to city with this message, training activists, and you know, it actually showed, because the first few months of me touring here last year in January, a massive media, you know, campaign happened, basically by virtue of a documentary we filmed with the BBC.
Yeah.
And after that, they found out a bit about my past, and then they sort of, it was more like they targeted me, used me as sort of a poster boy for veganism, mm-hmm. and they liked to attack my character a lot, bring out my past as of crime, yeah. and drugs, but for me, I felt
which
like
is
that
part of it, right?
Yeah,
it has to be part of it in a way, because you know that's the man behind the message.
Yeah, and also like I think media really do like the controversy as well. They want something to latch onto, and for me, like if that was my sort of Trojan horse to be able to speak the animal's message in the media, then so be it. I'm willing to be the punching bag for the media if I can still say pigs are lowered down into gas chambers. Cows are forcibly impregnated, have their children stolen from them and killed. So I'm still, I can still be the message for the animals, even if I'm the punching bag for the media.
Is that, did you have this same message when you were in Australia?
The same message?
Yeah.
Yeah, but
how receptive is it there compared to over here?
I feel like the vegan movement's growing really big in Australia really quick. It's just, for me, here was easier for me to travel around from city to city, and like Australia was a lot more flying, but here I was allowed to cover a lot more ground a lot easier, and the media in Australia have been onto it as well recently. There's been a release of a film called Dominion, which highlights, you know, you've seen Dominion? Yeah. It's
full on.
I mean, it's 2 hours of some of the most hectic footage you'll ever see. And people say, well, they're isolated incidents, you know, they've taken the worst of the worst. But a lot of these investigations are only a couple of days they're leaving cameras in there. Okay, they're just leaving cameras in for a couple of days, and they're pulling stuff out, and they're always finding horrific stuff in these places. And yeah, so the Dominion movement has been huge in Australia, and it's sort of bringing light to the darkness. It's bringing what happens behind closed doors, what happens in secrecy, out to the public's view. And it's like, well, here you go. This is what mass-produced animal products look like.
Mm.
Do you think this is morally justified?
Mm. Yeah. So anyone that's seen that film would hope that that's certainly not the case in most farms, even the large industrial ones, because if you looked at that footage, I mean, it's harrowing. A lot of it is extremely harrowing. And when you have industry bodies that then come out and say, well, this is not the majority of the industry, these are isolated cases, we're moving to ban pig stalls and so forth, then you've got two messages from extreme sides of the fence. Do you trust the industry that wants to protect itself, or do you trust the vegans that don't want you to eat meat?
Well, the vegans who want to defend animals and the industry who have vested interest.
Mm.
Okay.
But both groups have vested interest.
Vested in monetarily?
Well, your moral interest is surely greater than anything monetarily.
Yeah, but see, industry are making money off the exploitation and murder of animals. Vegans care about animals and are speaking up against it as an issue of justice.
Mm.
Okay, so who would you trust?
Well, I'd say that both motivations are just as strong.
Yeah, one's motivated by money and exploiting beings who can't speak for themselves, and the others are motivated by justice and fairness.
Moral imperative, emotional attachment, just as strong as any monetary.
Yeah, and like, we live in a society that, you know, we have laws protecting human beings, you know. We even have laws protecting certain animals. But when it comes to industry exploiting and killing millions of animals, all of a sudden it's, you know, it's just, you know, business.
Yeah. We all good, boys? I'm assuming we're good, Gerald.
Yeah, tweet one thing there, mate.
I've been looking forward to chatting to you.
That's cool. You're
fine. We do multiple stories at a time, but you know, when you start to look into one thing, it's always really the same with these stories where you have an initial thought about it, and then once you get into the detail of it, it opens up a whole other world.
Yeah, that's what it was like for me, man.
Yeah.
And I was just like everyone else, you know, eating the same big steaks every single night, eating pigs for breakfast, eating chickens for lunch. I never thought twice about it. Mm. I'd buy free-range eggs because I thought that was a moral choice.
Mm.
Never looked into this. I've trusted industry for so long,
mm.
and I was lied to. I felt like I was betrayed,
mm.
and it all makes sense to me now.
Mm. Well, what do you think about smaller farms? I've worked on farms,
mm.
dairy farms.
Farms.
Sure have, yeah. My family has sheep farms as well, and that's very different to what you see in Dominion, of course.
Of course.
You know, these animals are living a life, and that life gets ended in the end, but it's certainly nowhere near the kind of torture or suffering that is portrayed.
On the farm, no. Yeah, and I know that there are farms that are like that, and they genuinely care about their animals, okay? They've just been conditioned to see animals as a resource, as products, and they think it's the only way. And I'm sure they do. There are farms that have this high welfare standard for their animals. You know, they call them by their names and they come in. At the end of the day, they're not viewing those animals as individuals in every sense, because they're sending them to the slaughterhouse, and what happens in there is morally reprehensible. It's absolutely disgraceful. They're shot in the head and have their throats slashed open. So a lot of these farmers, they feel like this is the way of life. This is how it's always been. They're brought into this traditionally, so it's passed on. But we're trying to change that. It's not the only way. And vegans aren't anti-farming. You know we need plants for our survival, for civilization. We're just anti-using sentient beings as products.
Mm-hmm.
So the issue and the fight really isn't with farmers, because farmers are just meeting a demand. They grow what the public want, okay? If the public start wanting potatoes, they're gonna grow more potatoes, okay? But at the moment, the public want dairy cheese. They want flesh. So what are the farmers going to produce? Dairy cheese and flesh. And if enough of the public want lots and lots of meat, what do they have to do? They have to make factories to meet that demand. So the problem exists. It all stems from viewing animals as products.
Mm. Where do you see the vegan movement today?
Where do I see it today? Growing exponentially. Okay. People are waking up en masse.
Worldwide.
I mean, you could take the most extreme scenarios of like out in some third world country where they're not exposed to social media. But I think for the most part in the Western world, Europe, Australia, America, Canada, it's growing exponentially because people have access to freedom of information online. We have our own media now.
You seem to be at the very pointy end of that.
Well, I guess I am, but the movement collectively works together. So there's different facets of the movement. There's the plant-based doctors who have their own movement to do with human health and revealing the lies of the medical industry. Okay, then we have the environmental movement, okay, who are focused on the resources and the land use and the Amazon being destroyed to grow soy to feed the livestock and cattle ranching, which is destroying the lungs of the earth. And then we have the animal rights movement, okay, which the word vegan is to do with animals. Okay, you can be plant-based for health and still exploit animals in other ways. But the word vegan is to do with animal rights, not viewing animals as products, using them.
But it's not just about what you eat, is it?
No.
It's bigger than that.
Yeah, it's about unjustified use of animals. If we don't, need to, then why are we doing it? We always use animals as the first resort. And it's becoming, destructive to our health and to the environment as well. And we would never accept that for certain animals, the treatment of, even if you take this happy farm that you've probably been on, these farms with this high welfare standards, and you probably haven't seen what you've seen in Dominion, it's probably, opened your eyes up to it a lot, but, this happy farm, they still get sent to the slaughterhouse to be chopped up for their bodies,
Yeah, that's right. But they wouldn't be on the planet unless they were there for the farm, for the people that grow.
Yeah, but they wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the farmers breeding them into existence. But does that morally justify murdering them for their bodies? I mean, should they be grateful for that existence?
Well, is it better to have a life than no life at all, is really the question.
Well, I would throw it into the human context. Is it moral to bring humans into existence for the sole purpose of using them as slaves and murdering them? We would never accept that. So why do we accept it in the animal context? Is it moral to bring dogs into existence, like they do in certain parts of China where they're farming dogs into existence, for the sole purpose of murdering them for their bodies? We would never accept that in that context. So why do we accept it in the context of certain species of animals? It's because we've been taught that certain species are here for our use, here to eat.
What if you just took it as more of a simple notion? Would a human being prefer to have lived and not have lived at all? Isn't that the same for an animal?
I don't want to live in a world where it morally justifies murdering someone just because you brought them into the world.
You say someone, I just want to be clear, when you're saying someone, you're talking about animals.
I'm talking about sentient lives who have a subjective experience. So when you look at an animal, there's a someone in there. And this is the problem. We don't see someone when we look at an animal. And this is the basis of discrimination. We discriminate on them. We think there's no one there. They're things. We look at them as objects. They're not objects.
This path that you're on, have you made more friends or more enemies?
Well, the thing about social change is it's not comfortable. And it never has been. Look throughout history. All the great leaders of the past were hated. And I'm not saying I'm a leader, but each and every vegan who stands up against this injustice, when the majority are contributing to it, are going to have some opposition, aren't they? We're forcing social change. This is how it happens. This is how history changes. We're changing the way society views animals. Okay? Animals cannot speak for themselves. That's the difference between their oppression and human oppression. Humans can form coalitions to defend themselves. Sheep will never be able to do that.
Do you see yourself as a leader of this movement?
I think I'm a leading voice, but I don't consider myself the leader of the movement. There's many different people who, are at the forefront. So I guess I would be one of the leaders. But we all are leaders in a sense.
One thing is of no doubt, and that's the rise of vegan activism. Do you support that?
Activism's the only way society will change. Being vegan simply isn't enough. Being vegan means you've stopped participating in the injustice, okay? It's a neutral position, being vegan. Vegan activism is actively trying to change the situation for animals. So you would never stand by while there was an injustice happening to, say, a dog being beaten on the street. Standing by and watching, not participating in that dog being beaten, that would be veganism, okay? Actively trying to stop the dog from being beaten would be vegan activism.
charging into restaurants for protests, stealing animals from farms? Would you support that?
Would I support that? I don't get in. So I support the reason they do it, okay? And I understand that for social change to happen, these more, you might consider more extreme forms of activism need to happen as well, okay? We all work in different ways. So these steakhouse disruptions, what do? They get people going, oh, those extreme vegans, and they're talking about it in the media. And then all the vegan advocates can come in and go, well, we agree with the reason they're doing it. I mean, it might not technically turn those people in the restaurant vegan. It might, you know, cause some negative press towards those people in there. It might cause some negative press towards vegans a little bit, maybe a lot. But it doesn't negate...
vegans that don't agree with
yeah,
that.
Yeah, there is. There is, because...
quite a lot of them.
If you look at the advocacy I do, it's public outreach, okay, Socratic method, respectful dialogue. Mm. Not always. I've stood in front of trucks before to stop trucks out in front of slaughterhouses. In my early days, I've said some pretty hectic things when I was very angry, you know, rightly so, when you see what happens in movies like The Minion. Do I participate in those forms of activism? Not personally, but I 100% support the reason why they're doing it. What's happening to animals is like, if you want to talk about extreme, you know, step inside of a slaughterhouse for 5 minutes, that's extreme.
Some people that we've spoken to term it as a form of, almost a form of terrorism. Some of these protests, the busting in the steakhouses, for instance.
Interesting, that word terrorism.
Yeah.
The word terrorism implies someone being terrorized. And, like, those activists are trying to stop animals from being literally butchered against their will. Okay, so who's the real terrorist here? Who's really being terrorized here? It's just like saying, okay, there's this bunch of people there, they're abusing these, you know, children or whatever. The children can't defend themselves. A bunch of activists come in, stop them and go, stop abusing those children, okay? Or your actions are causing this abuse and murder of children. Now, would you call those activists terrorists because they did something that was socially uncomfortable?
You're equating it to humans, though. It's different because of the terminology we use, the terminology that we've set up society.
It's an analogy, okay? Animals are innocent, they're sentient beings, okay? They can't defend themselves. Children are innocent, they're sentient beings, they can't defend themselves, okay? So I believe defending animals who can't defend themselves is akin to defending children who can't defend themselves. They're both, like, for me, morally on par.
I guess when it crosses into the realms of breaking into properties, committing crimes, things that are against the law, I think that's where most people have a big problem with it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess people have a problem with it because they have a problem with who you're defending. But if they were human beings in those farms being tortured and abused, they would have no problem with someone trespassing and taking footage and bringing it out. No one gets harmed in that situation.
No, but they're not human beings in that.
And exactly, and that's the problem, that we view animals as lesser than. Now, I'm
it
not saying...
It sounds like the problem that you have is with terminology, animals, humans.
Not necessarily, because even if there were certain species of animals in those farms, dogs, for instance, that were being tortured and abused, no one would have a problem with activists trespassing on there to gain that footage. No one would. It would be absolutely absurd to think that, oh, you would be, you know, in sort of viewed down more for going onto someone's property just to take some footage than you would for actually committing the abuse that happens in those farms. Why aren't the farmers being judged for what happens in there, and the activists are being persecuted for simply going in there with cameras, not harming anyone, rescuing injured or sick animals, taking them to sanctuary, to be held? You know, they're viewed as extreme, but the farmers who are doing it, the most of society who are consuming and paying for this cruelty, aren't viewed as extreme.
But again, that's the same problem with terminology and definitions. You call it rescue, the police would call it stealing.
Stealing implies animals are property. Now, I understand animals are considered property under law, but they are sentient beings at the end of the day. Okay? They are enslaved.
If you don't follow the laws that we have in society, what do you end up with?
I think laws have always been challenged. Now, I don't break the law, you know, commit crimes to do my activism. Okay, but do I think, like, trespassing onto someone's property to show the abuse that happens on their farm is bad? No, I think it's a noble act. I think it's a noble act. And how would the public know what they're consuming if it wasn't for activists? Farmers aren't going to, you know, show you what's up in there.
Can you be happy, healthy, fulfilled on a vegan diet?
Happy and healthy and fulfilled? Yeah, of course. I mean, a vegan diet doesn't necessarily mean a healthy diet, okay? Because you can have vegan junk foods, you know, chocolates and ice cream and pizza and processed vegan food. Vegan means to not exploit animals unjustifiably. But, you know, a whole foods plant-based diet is better for health. I mean, it reverses the number one killer of human beings, heart disease. So that's pretty big.
I've read lots of studies, some of them supporting a vegan lifestyle, others that don't as well. So it really depends on which study that you're using.
Yeah, and who they're funded by, who the studies are funded by.
Exactly. And some of them are, and some of them come with surprising results. I'm sure you know about the one in Austria recently, that 15,000 people in that study have found that of the vegetarians and the vegans that they surveyed, they had a healthy body weight, but when it came to visit to the doctors, problems like anxiety, mental health, and depression, it was worse than the healthy meat eaters.
Healthy meat eaters. I'll have to look at this study and who they actually studied for this survey. You know, I don't know what who they looked into for that. I mean, all I can tell you is that cholesterol is building up in people's arteries and causing the number one killer of humans. We all know worldwide that the number one killer of humans is heart disease, okay? And saturated fat and cholesterol build up in people's arteries. I mean, there's conflicting science. You might say, oh, you know, this one here is funded by the egg industry. They're saying cholesterol is...
Control studies all day.
Yeah. But if we can be healthy without, you know, doing what we do to animals and doing what we do to the environment to get those animal products, why wouldn't we? I mean...
A question from a good friend of mine, because I spoke to a lot of people before we came on the story, who can't eat legumes, can't have wheat, can't have grain. Very difficult to get a balanced diet as a vegan.
Yeah, but they can eat eggs which contain cholesterol and cause heart disease and, you know, environmentally destructive animal products and, you know, products that cause exploitation and harm to animals. I'm sure you could design a vegan diet to suit any medical condition. I mean, you're talking about, you know, a minute fraction of society. This wouldn't be true if you applied it across the board to the majority. The majority of people can adhere to a vegan diet, and you can design it in a certain way.
You'd be very aware of this, or we're starting to understand a lot more about our gut and our gut health.
Yeah.
And everybody responds differently to different foods, and some people just don't respond well to a plant-based diet. Some people don't respond well to a meat-based diet either. Shouldn't we be eating for what our bodies are designed for, or what they function best at?
A true carnivore cannot develop heart disease from eating meat. Okay. Lions cannot develop heart disease from eating a strict meat-based diet. Human beings are dying en masse from heart disease.
Are you saying no vegans have heart disease?
Vegans can get heart disease from eating oil. Okay, from deep-fried food. But a whole foods plant-based diet is the only diet proven to reverse the number one killer of humans. So based on that alone, that should be the diet we all steer towards. Now, there might be people who have trouble digesting fiber, but we can design a low-fiber diet for those people. There is really no moral justification for what we do to pigs in a gas chamber when we lower them down into that gas, murder them, stab them in the throat, drain them of their blood. And you could say, well, you know, a vegan diet, you know, hurts my tummy or something. Does that really justify gas chambering and stabbing someone to death? I mean, because we could apply this to dogs, you know. Would we say, oh, you know, a vegan diet doesn't work for everyone, and maybe some people have some tummy issues with a bit of fiber. Let's murder a bunch of dogs and eat their flesh because not everyone can be vegan. I mean...
I guess what I'm looking at it from is the way a lot of people would look at this argument and say, okay, let's put the animal stuff to one side. I know you can't do that, but let's assume that somebody's doing this. Can I be healthy on a vegan diet? And they would look at a healthy omnivore versus a healthy vegan, and a lot of studies would say that those two people are just as healthy as each other.
Except, like, let's just say one doesn't cause environmental destruction, harm of animals, and those two things should be enough to sway towards the vegan diet. I mean, the number one cause of Amazon deforestation, you know, the lungs of the earth, animal agriculture, nothing comes close. Palm oil doesn't even come close, you know, so environmental destruction alone. Species extinction, ocean dead zones, water pollution, land use.
Mm.
We're feeding 50% of the world's grain to animals, and there's starving children. You know, we're feeding all this grain to livestock. Those livestock are being bred by farmers.
Mm.
70 billion land animals murdered every year.
Mm.
So it's a huge environmental impact that's causing. So just based on that alone, wouldn't we steer towards a plant-based diet? Or not?
Mm. 7.7 billion people cannot continue eating meat in the way that, in which we are. That's...
In the way?
In the way.
Do you think there's any sustainable way to... Like, let's just take your scenario of... outdoor free-ranging farm, okay?
Yeah.
Cows take up how much more land than, you know, a factory farm situation. Intensive farming is better for the environment, but it's horrifically cruel.
Mm.
So these cows are taking up humongous amounts of land. They're deforesting the land to grass feed cattle as well. I mean, we just can't sustain it for the whole population. So a plant-based diet is the only way to sustain our current population.
Is there enough land in the world to feed 7.7 billion people on a vegan diet?
Well, they're currently growing enough. They're currently growing enough. 50% of the world's crops are fed to animals in you know, animal agriculture. So they're currently growing enough plants. It's just where they're feeding them. They're feeding them to all these animals while there's human beings starving.
So we have enough at the moment to feed the world's population?
Yeah. More than enough.
Mm.
More than enough.
On a vegan diet, what about some of the nutrients that are harder to find? Stuff like zinc, copper, iron, B12, omega-3s.
The only nutrient people, or the only vitamin people should be concerned about is B12, and that's across the board. B12 is added to animal feed, injected into animals, and animals also get it from eating the dirt when they pick up the grass. So it's a bacteria found in the soil and the water. Everything's sanitized now. Fruits and vegetables are sanitized, the dirt's been washed off, the water we drink has been chlorinated, so the B12 has been sort of, essentially the bacteria that create the B12 has been, you know, neutralized. So we have to supplement, and that's why the government add it to, you know, fortified foods, and they're injecting it into the animals and putting it in the animal feed so we can get enough B12. Everyone should be supplementing B12, including vegans and omnivores. But other than that, every other nutrient can be found in plants, if not directly in the plants, can be synthesized by the body.
What supplements do you take?
I don't actually take any supplements.
No.
The B12 is in my sort of fortified vegan food. So the soy milk that I drink is fortified with B12. The nutritional yeast that I sprinkle on my pasta or potatoes is fortified with B12. So I don't take any supplements. Yeah.
What about this argument? I know this is one you've spoken about a bit, that haven't we evolved this way? Humans have evolved to eat meat, to digest dairy. Isn't this just evolution?
It doesn't make it moral if we've evolved to do something that's inherently cruel. I mean, we've done many things in our past that are inherently immoral, and we wouldn't continue to do them just based on, you know, evolution. Our stomach... You know, just because we can digest meat doesn't mean it's optimal and doesn't mean we should continue to do it. I mean, there might have been situations in the past, and I'm on board with that, where, you know, they were hunting animals and doing something to survive, doing what they had to do to survive. It doesn't morally justify it now, and the fact is that it's destroying, literally going to obliterate the environment, okay? Destroying human health, and it's inherently cruel and abusive, so it's something that we need to change.
Mm. Are we not the apex predator? Isn't this a fact of life, the circle of life?
Well, define an apex predator. What do you mean by an apex predator? I mean, I could throw you in the ocean with a shark, and I'm sure you wouldn't be a predator in that scenario.
99% of the time on land, we are the apex predator. We don't have an animal that threatens our species.
Being an apex predator does not morally justify abusing the innocent and defenseless if we have alternatives. Okay?
Is this not the animal kingdom? Animals, I've been to the Serengeti, watched animals eat each other alive. Is it any worse than,
whoa,
is it any worse than what we're doing?
You wouldn't eat me alive just because you saw a tiger do that. So you wouldn't mirror the actions of an animal in a moral, civilized society. So you don't look at what lions do in a survival situation on the savannah and go, oh, we should act like lions. We would never apply that in any other context. We're a civilized society, okay? So we have moral agency. Animals in the wild do not. So we have a responsibility to act in a moral way.
I guess the point I'm making is, if animals were left to roam freely, it's a brutal world for them out there. They eat each other alive. So is what we're doing all that different?
If animals were allowed to roam freely, we wouldn't be breeding billions of them into existence to subjugate them, torture and kill them every year. Okay? If we were there to be guardians of the earth, be guardians of the animals, okay, intervene when necessary, live more, you know, in alignment with nature, with animals, then that would be better than what we're doing now. What happens in nature happens in nature. Good and bad things both happen in nature. We can't use what happens in nature to morally justify our actions in a civilized society.
Isn't that what life is, though, Joey? A beautiful struggle that ends in tragedy.
It doesn't justify murder. That's what life is. This is just the way it is. You know, we have a responsibility to act in a moral way. It wouldn't justify me going up to someone's dog and stabbing them in the throat, eating their body parts. You might say, well, that's a bit extreme, but that's what we're doing. We're going, well, lions in the jungle eat meat. Aren't I designed to eat meat so I can go and kill whoever, whatever animal I want and eat their bodies? Because lions do that, and, you know, I need to get my iron and B12 out of that dog's flesh. Morals don't exist because, you know, there's no morals in nature. This is just ludicrous. We don't apply this in any other context except for our abuse of certain species of animals.
This gets to the point of species equality. What does that mean exactly?
Species equality? Now, people get confused and they say, well, you think animals are on exactly equal to humans in every way and we should treat them exactly equal to humans in every way. Driver's license, you know, completely equal rights in every scenario. I'm just asking for their right to life, to live without being enslaved, subjugated, treated as property, okay, treated as products. So we would never treat human beings the way we treat animals. We just wouldn't. We've got rights protecting us.
Some parts of the world they do.
But we wouldn't morally justify it. We wouldn't say that that's okay, or that's good, or that's moral. Okay, some parts of the world they do, yeah. I mean, we still murder each other, don't we? We don't accept it, though.
We do horrific things to each other.
Yeah. Do you think that's okay?
No.
Of course you don't.
No.
So that doesn't justify us doing horrific things to animals.
Again, it's because of this. The problem seems to be the boundary. We've drawn a boundary between humans and animals, and you don't see that boundary.
We discriminate against certain species of animals based on their species alone and the way they look. And we've said sheep, chickens, cows, pigs, fish, they're our property, they're our food, do what we want to them. They don't exist in the moral world at all. They're just outside of our, you know, moral system. Dogs, though, oh my God, if anyone did anything to a dog, you know, string them up, burn them alive. These are people who eat pigs. If you ever go to a dog post where some dog's been, you know, treated cruelly, look at all the people who eat pigs. This person should have the same thing happen to them, what they're doing to that dog. Oh my God, kill them, bash them, you know. You've ever had a dog. But pigs, you know, gas chamber them, stab them to death, have them on toast with bacon. Bacon, make jokes about it, no problems. Do you see the problem there?
I do see the problem, and the world would be a very confusing and upsetting place if you saw every animal's life equal
to each other.
That's right.
I would say, what difference does a pig have to a dog? That, you know, we sell chopped up pig bodies in the supermarket, no one blinks an eye. But if that was a dog, you know, we would all be crying bloody murder.
Oh, we'd call them pets. So, domesticated animals, there's boundaries that have been drawn.
But that doesn't change the value of that animal. So you're saying animals only have the value we assign to them, not their own sentient value of them being their own individual. This is a problem. So you're saying we can devalue animals just by going, they're a pig, they're food, chop them up, kill them, they're a dog, they're a pet, look after them, you know, nurture them. What about the individual? That's all from our eyes. That's not from their eyes. Look at it from the animal's perspective for 1 second. You tell me if it's morally justified. You tell me if you would accept any of your justifications for killing them if you were that animal. And that's what vegan activists do. We look at it from the eyes of the victim, not from the eyes of human being.
Do you see the lives of all animals as being equal?
As completely equal in every sense? I think there's things that are different about us all. But you know, I'm not going to say that you are the same as a mouse, okay? But I'm going to say that we have many similarities between animals, and we should focus on what we have in common, which is we avoid pain and suffering. We are having our own subjective sentient experience of reality, okay? We all desire well-being. So focus on those similarities and say, does that morally, are we morally justified to rob them of their sentience, to take away their well-being, to increase their pain and suffering because I want a cheeseburger?
What about when it comes to the lives of animals? Mice, rodents, insects get killed by pesticides, insecticides, combine harvesters, producing the foods that vegans eat.
They do.
And those lives just as important.
Omnivores eat that same those same plant foods, so they're causing all of those accidental justified deaths for the plants that we need to survive, and they're also causing all of this unjustified harm for the trillions of animals that are killed for the burgers and flesh that we don't need to survive.
Isn't it hypocritical for vegans to be eating those foodstuffs knowing that those animals have died to produce it?
What other choice do we have? We need plants to survive and be healthy. Without plants, we die. So there are justified deaths and justified harm that happens for the good of civilization. I'm not against civilization existing. I don't want to fall out in the jungle not stepping on an ant. But I also understand there's unjustified things we do to animals for an unnecessary reason, like eating their body parts, which cause us heart disease and the destruction of the earth. Now,
so you'd still deem, though, the death of some animals is necessary for human survival?
100%, so is the death of humans. We accept accidental deaths of human beings in civilization as well. Construction deaths, road accidents, okay? I'm not against transport, okay? These are justified deaths for the good of civilization. So we accept it in the human context. I don't have some out there, apply some out there moral value to animals. We're consistent with that. Humans die for civilization, so do animals, and crop deaths. And people use that as a justification for walking up, stabbing a pig, and chopping them up, and eating their body, and saying, well, vegans are hypocrites. It's a cop out. I mean, we wouldn't say, I just murdered someone's dog, right? But it's morally justified because vegans eat bread and, you know, animals die in accidental combine harvester deaths and insects are sprayed with pesticide to protect crops.
Yes, but when people are talking about species equality and you're standing outside a farm saying no animals should be harmed, but still knowing that animals are harmed for the...
Well, I think people have vegans. This misconception that vegans think they cause no harm, and that's the problem. And I never said we don't cause any harm whatsoever. I've never said that in my advocacy. I'm aware of crop deaths. I'm aware of justified harm for the good of civilization because we have it in the human context as well. Okay? So I think it's all a misconception of what veganism is. Now, unjustified places like slaughterhouses, breeding animals into the existence for the sole purpose of enslaving them, stabbing them to death and eating their bodies when we don't need to, that's different to growing plant foods that we need for our survival and our health and for civilization to function and for humanity. You know, that's completely different.
Is the ability to be vegan the realm of a privileged few in first world countries with money and choice?
That's interesting. That is a very interesting argument because the cheapest food per calorie on earth is rice. Okay? Now, that is not a luxury. What is a luxury, though, is taking 50% of the world's grain that could otherwise be fed to starving countries in these, Africa where there's starving children. We're taking that grain, we're feeding it to animals to fatten them up so we can have steak.
So the families that you would see in India that are using the cows out the back to feed the family, the families that I've seen in Paraguay with the chicken coop out the back, they don't have these options that you're talking about.
Let's just talk about not having options. For the most people who are watching this right now, they do have options. So you can point to some far out there scenario, I met this person in India who would have died if they didn't have their cow who was producing milk. That's a different context to you.
But aren't you after a vegan world? Is it possible?
You know what? Once we deal with those who have options here, then we can deal with the people in India who have no option and we can debate whether they do have an option or don't.
So it would start, though, in privileged first world countries.
I would say that animal products are a privilege. I would say that animal products are a privilege, and what we're doing to the environment to get those animal products and the resources, that's greed. That's human greed.
One of the problems I see that you're facing is personal choice, people's freedom of choice.
Yes. Get that one a lot. A personal choice ceases to be personal when you're robbing someone of their life against their will. Where was the animal's choice in this? So it's a choice. I'm not disputing it's a choice, but it's not a personal choice. You know, me drinking some bourbon, you know, getting drunk, that might be a personal choice. It's bad for my health, but it's a personal choice. I don't encroach on people's personal choice. Mm. But when there's a victim involved, it ceases to be personal. It's a choice that has a victim.
Mm. So in a society, though, where we have boundaries, we have laws, we have criminal laws even that we need to operate within.
Mm-hmm.
Taking the life or eating meat does not overstep those boundaries.
Yeah, neither did slavery, human slavery back in the past. Human slavery in America, the transatlantic slave trade, that was legal. The Holocaust was legal. What is legal doesn't equal what is immoral. Okay? And laws take time to catch up to the morality.
Do you think we'll see laws eventually that ban the consumption of animals?
I think we need laws protecting animals from murder, just like we do for humans. I think that we need that. They need that. They need rights to bodily integrity, a right to life, and a right not to be enslaved and treated like nothing.
Until we have that, how do you get people to put down their personal choice, their personal freedom, to make that decision?
Well, we educate people as to why it's not a personal choice. We try to influence people and try to speak to their hearts and their compassion. Okay, because most people are compassionate humans. They don't want to see what happens to animals. They don't want to contribute to what happens to animals. That's why we show them and we speak to their heart and we say, we know you're a good person. This is unjustified. Look at those animals suffering. They're being murdered for your burger. And we have alternatives. We have Beyond Burgers. We have all these amazing plant-based alternatives now. It's destroying the environment. It's harming these beautiful creatures that are intelligent. They want to live just like your dog at home does. And we speak to their compassion and we hope they make the moral choice.
I feel strongly about this, don't you? You're driven by it.
It drives me every single day. It
consumes you.
Well, it's an injustice. It's an injustice. And if that was me in those cages about to be murdered, I want someone to speak for me as well.
Wouldn't it be better? Wouldn't it be certainly a hell of a lot easier for your battle to try and improve the welfare of animals, try to eliminate food waste that we have?
Food waste? What do you mean?
A third of all food that we produce is wasted. Fruits and veggies is up 50%. It gets thrown out, chucked in the bin. That's part of the big problem with supermarkets.
I mean, there's other problems. There's other problems. I mean, there's many different other... There's many other problems. Look.
But there's two things that... this is my point.
Okay, yeah, make your point.
Here's two things that people would agree with you with instantaneously, which is better welfare for animals, certainly, right? Better welfare for animals, and certainly when it comes to the industrial production of animals.
Yeah.
You know, that would certainly need to be looked at.
Most people are against factory farming, but most people consume the products of factory farming, which is, in my view, complete hypocrisy. But define welfare. Is knifing someone in the throat welfare? Well, do we accept that in the human context for welfare? That's not welfare.
Most people might accept that if they had a life that was free of torture.
I would not accept that. That is not welfare. That is not in the animal's best interest. Shooting them in the head and slashing them across their throat is not in the animal's best interest. That is not welfare.
Mm.
No matter how nice you treat them beforehand, if you treat someone nicely before you rape them, or if you treat someone nicely before you murder them, that doesn't justify the act of rape and it doesn't justify the act of murder.
Mm. So that welfare argument for you doesn't wash at all.
If we tell people, hey, there's abuse happening in factory farms, there's murder happening in slaughterhouses where these high welfare animals go, they all go to the same hellhole slaughterhouse torture chamber to be stabbed in the neck, okay? Then we hope people make a different choice when they're at the supermarket, because they can't avoid murder and they can't avoid torture, whichever way you look at it.
With an argument like that, wouldn't it be easier to try and change the consumption of meat, to lower the consumption of meat of the many, other than trying to get the very few to abstain altogether?
You know what? People are going to lower their meat consumption if we give them the right message to begin with. Now, if I tell people, reduce, 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 what is that? So subjective. What, you eat 10 steaks a day, now you're going to eat 3? I'd rather tell people the truth, that eating steak causes abuse of animals, causes the murder of animals, it's causing the destruction of the earth, and the number one killer of human beings. That's the truth. Now, if they reduce because I said the truth to them, that's their choice. But I'd rather give people the full truth, so those who are willing to make the full moral choice do.
the number one reason that people turn vegan, correct me if I'm wrong, is for health benefits.
Maybe. That might be true. But
second, very close second, is the welfare of animals. So
you define welfare.
You,
yeah.
That would take a long time between you and I, but do you have the right message?
So the health arena, which I think is very good for bringing people in, because you know a lot of people they operate, you know, for selfish reasons, which is understandable. I mean, when you put our existence at stake, people are more likely to act. So the environment, saying the environment is being destroyed because of animal agriculture, which is an undeniable fact, you know, gets people to wake up and go, wow, well, we're at stake now. You know, it's our lives at stake now. So those same with the health, you know, the health argument, but it brings people into the ethical argument. When you take people off of the animal products, they have mental clarity, they feel better, and then they start, you know, getting involved with the vegan movement, and they see there's a lot more to it than just health. Health doesn't keep people vegan, by the way. Health doesn't even really turn people vegan, because you can eat a plant-based diet for health. You can still wear leather, you can still use products that are tested on animals, you can still go to circuses, you can have a dog breeding facility where you, you know, sell dogs and, you know, do immoral things to animals but eat a plant-based diet. But a vegan lifestyle is what eliminates all this exploitation.
Would that be a more effective message, though? Because whenever I hear vegans talking to omnivores, meat eaters, it's generally about the welfare of animals. What I don't hear a lot about is diet and health, which is, from what I can see, the number one reason that people turn vegan.
You cannot turn completely vegan for health, which is my point. Okay, you can eat a plant-based diet for health, whole foods plant-based diet, and there's a whole other movement to do with health that you just aren't aware of. I mean, there's a film called What the Health. I mean, people go, oh, they debate on whether the science is correct. You can debate with the science, but there's a whole arena of plant-based doctors who are working this out. Okay, so that's, you know, I'm not an expert in the health arena. There's plenty of people who are, and that debate that constantly, and that's coming into the movement as well. I think each argument is very strong, and they all work together.
If you Google the vegan movement, vegan activism, your name is the first one that comes up.
Really?
The first thing, you're on the first page.
Okay.
Is this a full-time job for you?
It was a very... This was a passion for me, okay? Like, I had this fire inside of my heart. I had a very rough background, okay? I was involved in gangs, drugs, and I landed myself in prison for carrying a loaded firearm. And when I was in prison, I had this awakening, and it was... part of it was due to my sobriety. So I've seen my life with new eyes. I've seen that my life was just a collection of all the mistakes I'd made in my past, and it had led me to this point. And when I was released, I started to see things more clearly, and I started to want to give back. I thought, you know, I've been causing people distress for all these years, and, you know, I turned my life around. And I had the vegan seed planted in my mind about health, and, you know, I understood the hypocrisy in claiming to care about some animals, and, you know, dogs and cats and save the whales, but I had another piece of an animal on my plate, and I was living with this hypocrisy in my heart, and I thought I would align that, and I went vegan. But it wasn't enough for me, because I was like, how could this be happening on such a scale and everyone not be speaking up about it? So I had this fire inside of my chest, and it drove me. It drove me, like, and everything else has followed from that.
How long have you been vegan?
5 years.
What happened in prison specifically?
It was my sobriety that woke me up when I was in prison. It was the longest I had been sober for since I was about 14. So, yeah, the sobriety helped me see things clearly and helped me align.
Becoming sober doesn't generally turn people vegan. Is there what happened in prison to turn you vegan?
Okay, so while I was on house arrest, before my prison sentence, I put on a lot of weight. So I got clinically obese. I was 115 kilograms, depressed, anxious, you know, I was a mess. And I was like, I've had enough of this. I want to find the best diet to lose weight. So I was on the internet, YouTube scouring around, and I found a raw foodist. Okay, this raw foodist was juicing fruits and vegetables, and he was talking about, like, you know, plants containing, you know, minerals and water, and he felt like plants are life-giving. And when you eat dead food, like the piece of an animal that suffered and died, You're taking on everything that animal went through, you know, their suffering before they died, their anxiety, and you're eating dead food, and this isn't good for the body. It manifests as disease, and it planted a seed, okay? So I did this fruits and vegetables, and I lost a lot of weight, dropped 25 kilograms. It planted a very important seed because I was like, wow, I never felt as amazing as I did drinking these fruit and vegetable juices and eating plants. Clarity, and, you know, this planted an important seed that flourished later on.
The message that you're giving at the moment, the path that you're on, if this is a full-time job, where does the funding come from for that?
My funding is donation-based.
Okay. Yeah. Is it a charity?
Yeah, donation-based. Everyone gets together, they might drop a fiver a week or a month, and everyone gets behind me because they feel like they want to stand behind my work. Okay, so I used to work as a traffic controller 3 days a week, and for me that was sort of cutting my motivation in half, because I'd have to worry about money and going to work, and it would sort of dilute my motivation, and I could only give about 60% for the animals. And I made the step to sort of ask for help from people. I say, hey, look, if you believe in my work, you know, would you get behind me? And this was a very big thing for me to do, because part of my ego wanted to, you know, do it without any help. I thought I could work a job and do this at the same time. But when I started to get the funding and I could focus on this 100% of the time, I put all my focus into it, to this is when things really started to change.
This is a personal question, but can I ask what kind of money you get donated to live on?
What kind?
How much? Say, how much in a year would you get donated?
I don't divulge my income to, you know, the whole world. I mean, I can ask you the same thing. How much do you make?
I'm not the name of the message today.
Yeah. I get enough to get me by, to get me travelling around, to pay for equipment. Fine. If I ever need any more to do some type of big tour, donors will get behind us. It's great. I don't have to worry about that.
True or false? The louder you are, the more controversial you are, the more donations you get.
I mean, people could say that, you know, I'm doing all this to get donations, and where's your evidence for that? I mean, you're not a mind reader, you know, you don't know who I am. You know, this is something I've dedicated my life to, and I did before I was getting donations. You know, I've been doing this since I was vegan. I've been outspoken about this. Just so happens that now I'm getting supported for it for the last year.
But the more people you reach, the louder you are. The more reach you have, the more donations you get.
The more animals that are saved, the more people that go vegan, the quicker the world changes. Donations aren't really my motivation. You know, I don't have desires to have a beautiful house and a big car. You know, I sleep on a single bed in a hotel or on my mate's couch or on a mate's bed. You know, I travel around with this message and I dedicate my entire life to it. Donations have helped me do that. Without them, you know, I would be working, you know, holding a sign on the side of the street, not creating any social change.
It's a difficult life, Joe.
It's got its ups and downs, but it's nowhere near as difficult as it was for me in my past, in the gangs and on drugs.
Let's talk a little bit about that, because you have a long criminal history.
Yeah.
We're talking about the three assaults.
Yeah.
House arrest.
Yep.
6 months in prison.
Yeah.
A lot of drug use.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And for me, it all started when I was about 14 years old and I lost youth. Really didn't understand society too much. And, you know, I wouldn't say the household was a stable environment for me. And I found solitude in the drug use, and I found people who I thought were like me, you know. So similar sort of environment at their home. They might come from a low income community. And, you know, we found camaraderie with each other. And we started to knock around and, you know, get up to no good. And what happens is it graduates into something, you know, more toxic, a little bit worse. We all start to, you know, get older, things get a little bit more serious, and before you know it, you're in prison.
So you were arrested with a firearm, 2 flick knives, 29 bullets. You were certainly looking at doing some harm to humans at some point.
It was more defense. It was more to protect myself, because I was in such a dangerous environment and fueling myself on drugs. I was very paranoid and I was concerned about my safety. So if you're in a dangerous environment like that, it's either sink or swim. Mm. And you've got to do what you've got to do to protect yourself. It wasn't like I had intentions of going doing some unjustified harm to someone. It was more, you know, I've got to do what I've got to do to protect myself. I don't know what could happen to me. So to have these weapons was a security blanket for me.
Mm. Can people trust a man with a criminal history like that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to live in a world where someone can't do wrong and then redeem themselves for it. I mean, I'm genuine in my heart. I mean, I've got nothing to hide now. I was the one who divulged my criminal history to everyone. You know, this has been a big part of my evolution. I mean, trust me or not, is what I'm saying true? Look into it. You know, don't take my word for this. The information is out there for people to see. I'm just a messenger for it. Now, I had this conversation with Piers Morgan, and he liked to bring up my character on television. And he's like, well, you know, you got caught with this flick knife, you got caught with this gun, you know. That's not an argument to what I'm saying. Is the dairy industry inherently abusive? You know?
The reason I bring it up is because you're the man behind the message.
Yeah.
People are going to understand your message and perhaps follow it. They're going to want to know about you.
Of course.
And can they trust you?
It's not just my message. There's a movement of millions of people who speak exactly the same message. Slight nuances, but the same fundamental core message. It's not my message, it's the message of the animals.
Mm. I saw, tell me if this is wrong or if it's right or it's wrong, but I saw a disturbing quote that allegedly came from your mum saying that you were one of the scariest creatures on the planet.
I, to be honest, back then, you wouldn't have recognised me. I was a different person, and you know, that's what being in that type of environment does to you. It starts to shape you. That's what using alcohol and drugs does to you. It starts to shape you into someone that you're not. But my true essence was good. You know, it was just that I was clouded. You know, I was clouded by all this negativity. You know, I was trying to survive in a very rough environment and I lost myself. But part of my sobriety was finding myself again, finding that compassionate heart that I have, and now using that compassionate heart to defend animals and defend the innocent.
Much of it, that is a huge change for a person to make.
It is a huge change, and my family just couldn't believe it at the start. And I don't think people trusted it or believed it at the start, but it's 5 years now, and I ain't going back.
Mm. How is your relationship with your family, with your mother now?
Amazing. Amazing. Mum's so happy and proud. My father, before he passed away, he got to see the change, and he died knowing that, you know, I wasn't involved in that anymore. When I pulled myself out of that lifestyle, I pulled myself completely out of that lifestyle. I didn't associate with anyone. I didn't take any drugs, substances. You know, I completely removed myself and completely changed, and I haven't looked back. Okay, and that's evident to see. And my mum's, you know, grateful every single day, and I'm always there for her now. And, you know, she gets a little bit worried, but in a different sense now, like, am I okay? Am I working too hard? But at least I'm channeling, you know, my passion that I have in a good way, you know, not being self-destructive.
Were you this full-on beforehand? You're a very intense person.
Yeah, I've always been passionate. I guess now I'm directing it in a productive way, I feel like, and something that I'm sort of channeling it to do good.
Is this, I guess what I'm asking you, is this your personality, to be so intense?
I guess it is, but when I talk about my life and animals, it's a very heavy topic for me. So of course the passion's gonna come out. I mean, there's situations where you get me when I'm having a laugh and I'm, you know, a bit more laid back. When I'm talking about injustice that happens to innocent animals, it's on par with child abuse to me. It's a very serious topic for me. Mm. So I'm passionate about it.
How important has social media been to you?
Social media is one of the most important parts of the vegan movement for getting this message out. Mm. It's single-handedly been one of the most powerful ways to get the truth out to people.
Mm. I just want to read a couple of your posts. I just want to ask you about them.
Yeah.
2016. Yeah. You were a disgusting psychopath.
Yeah.
Another one. Hitler is still alive and he lives in the hearts and mind of every animal abusing, rapist, slave owning dairy farmer.
Yeah.
Australian dairy farmers should do the cows a favour, kill yourselves, and unethical hunters deserve a bullet in the head. I hope one of these bastards accidentally shoot one of their family members in the face.
Yeah. Yep. So those quotes, we can unpack each of those if you like. I'm happy to, because
Start as a whole.
Okay, so when I first started advocating fresh out of games, and I was angry for what was happening to animals, okay? So angry. I was like, how can we do this to them? I've seen so much abuse, seen what was happening in slaughterhouses. And I was just speaking, you know, from a place of anger and aggression.
Do you still feel this way? Because this is extreme.
100% do not stand by those statements anymore. Now, we can unpack each of those statements and why I said them. But do I advocate like that now? You can look at my stuff that I have online. I've actually deleted anything that I feel like I don't stand behind now. Because I know I understood it come from a place of anger back then. You know, I was like, you know, how can we do this to animals? This is what the animals would say if they were the victim, you know, and misguided from a place of anger. Now, if you look at any of my videos now, don't advocate like that at all. I mean, I would still say that animals are enslaved, dairy cows are raped. I mean, I wouldn't take that away from the animals. Their plight is their plight. But, you know, I don't direct it with aggression and insult anymore.
How would people know that you don't still feel this way, but you just wrap it in a different veneer?
Because you'd have to take my advocacy as a whole. I mean, what I put out there. I mean, if I don't stand by things I said when I'm angry. I'm sure people have said angry things to people who kill dogs in China as well. But, you know, things are said out of anger.
Most people don't advocate for people to go and kill themselves. This is...
What, are you telling me that if you've seen someone lighting a dog on fire while they were fully conscious, you know, causing them harm, I'm taking the example of, you know, someone abusing an innocent animal. Most of society would be like, yeah, kill yourself. Right? Now, when I said that statement about dairy farmers, like, that was an insensitive thing for me to say. I didn't look at it from the dairy farmer's perspective at all. I was looking at it from the perspective of the dairy calves, the innocent calves that are taken away and killed, the mothers who are exploited, sexually abused, have their children taken away from them year after year, and they were pouring their milk down the drain. They were pouring these dairy calves, stolen, killed, murdered dairy calf milk down the drain. And farmers were suicidal because their industry was collapsing. I didn't have sympathy for the farmers at the time. Now I have a more of a rounded view on this. I understand farmers are indoctrinated into this system, okay? And they don't see it from the animal's perspective. They just see it as industry to them. So I understand and sympathize with them more. But the animals are the true victims here. Now, that was a misguided and statement out of pure anger.
The message behind these statements is, if you kill another animal, you deserve to die yourself. Do you still feel that way?
If someone kills a human being, do I think they deserve to die? No, I think they need...
That's not the question.
But I'm using this exact analogy, because when I look at these...
Come back to the analogy, can you answer the question first?
If you kill an animal, do you deserve to die? I've killed animals before. So I don't think I deserve to die. I think I need to be educated. Okay, I think education is what's missing here. You know, educate. I think people that kill animals are a product of a society that thinks killing animals is normal, natural, and necessary.
You
and that's a problem. I don't think people should be killed or deserve to die for causing harm to others or animals. Okay, I think they need to be educated, okay, and that they need to be taught that animals are sentient beings that deserve our respect, and that it's not necessary. Because there's a different context surrounding someone who works in a slaughterhouse killing animals, okay, as a job that society says is okay, you know, and someone, you know, killing someone out of pure pleasure, just for the sake of torturing and killing someone. You know, one surrounded by industry, there's different contexts surrounding it. So I don't say, oh, but that person who works in a slaughterhouse deserves to die. That wouldn't be me looking at this problem rationally. Okay, so
the attention that you get for this, a lot of it is directed towards you in a negative way. Do you enjoy the attention?
Like, the negativity can get to me a lot, but it depends on what type of negativity. If it's people going, you know, we've got to eat animals to survive, lions eat animals, you stupid vegan, this and that, like, that doesn't really get to me as much. I guess when people question my integrity, when my heart is so devoted to this, that can make me feel a little bit like, you know, you don't know me, like, you don't know what I think. You don't know how much this means to me. You know, that can get to me a little bit. Constant bombardment, I mean, people attacking my character, you know, that can get to me. Bringing up old statements I've said doesn't really get to me that much because I don't stand by them anymore. I understand where they come from. I understood the psychology behind them, you know, because I see the psychology in other people. When they see an animal being abused, they get angry. Get your hands off that child or that animal. You know, we'll beat your ass. That's the way people are. That's the way anger works. Learning to channel my anger in a productive way, though, you know, it's not detrimental to me. It doesn't come across as, you know, aggressive. I think it's a bit of a learning experience.
I understand so much more about this issue now because I'm doing the story.
Yeah.
But before looking at this, I would probably look at the vegan movement like a lot of Australians would.
Yeah.
And as you said, a lot of it is misinformation, a lot of it is information facts that they don't have. But essentially, you need people to look at this movement, right? You need to get people to look behind the message, behind the veneer. How do you get around the problem of people looking at you and just thinking, here's just another whiny vegan trying to ram something down our throats?
I think with education-based advocacy and logic, I mean, what we're speaking about is a position most people hold anyway when it comes to certain animals. It's just that they throw all of their morals out the window when it comes to a certain species of animals, and it's just a complete contradiction. So helping expose that, it's just logic, really. And showing that to people they have an emotional connection to their dog and the pig that was stabbed to death for their burger isn't much different. You know, this is just pointing out an obvious truth. I mean, showing people a slaughter happened on, hey, what do you think about that? That makes you hungry? You know, what's the problem there? So there are going to be people that are opposed to this message. Of course they are. There are going to be people that defend meat eating vehemently. You know, farmers that are, you know, completely protesting this. But that's not going to stop this movement, you know. This is going to happen whether or not people are liking it at the start, okay? Because the truth is the truth. It cuts through everything.
Is that upsetting, though, that the majority of people are going to see you as just another whining vegan?
You know, how people view me versus how people view the message, two different things. So people can say what they want about me, about my character, about whether they like me or they don't. Let's talk about my message here. Look into it. Look into what I'm saying. See if it's false. Don't worry about me. I'm just a vessel for the message.
What would you say about a person... What would you think about a person who eats only meat in their diet? Only. No fruits, no veggies, no nuts. Only meat.
I would be concerned about their health and think that they have got some misinformation to think that they're a full carnivore. I mean, there's nothing about our anatomy that shows that we're a carnivore. We don't have claws, we don't have big sharp teeth, we don't have the digestive tract of a lion to pass through meat quickly. I think he's on getting a one-way ticket to bowel cancer, he or she. And I would wonder why they think that that's, you know, healthy or needed.
If you had a chance to talk directly to Australia, what would you say?
I would say look inside of your heart when you think about these issues. Don't worry about the messenger. Think about the message here. Are you fundamentally against the abuse and unnecessary murder of animals? You know, do you love your dog that eat a piece of a pig's body inside your sandwich every day? Are you being morally consistent? Are you being honest with yourself? Face the truth. Watch movies like Dominion. Tell me if you think that's okay. Does this align with the good person that you are? And then act on that.
Joey, thank you very much.
Appreciate your time, mate. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else you want to add?
Go vegan.